Anyway, today, ladies and gentlemen, I am thrilled to have with us today my friend Terry Fator. I've got some bio stuff here. I don't think any of it is true, Terry. I think you just made it up. But Terry Fator became a household name in 2007 when he won season 2 of America's Got Talent with his unique brand of entertainment that combines singing, comedy, and unparalleled celebrity impressions. I'm not going to really, you know, I'm just going to let us talk and you can tell us more. I don't want to get into the bio. Terry Fator, I'm thrilled to have you with us today.
It is such a pleasure, Steve. And I've known you for a long time from all the military things we've done together. So
absolutely. That's where we met, doing some things, supporting military. And then it was really an honor. Several years ago, we both sang at the National Finals Rodeo.
We did.
In Las Vegas. And I think you sang maybe America the Beautiful or something, and I sang the anthem. And that was really the first time I remember being able to really talk with you a little bit, and you were so gracious, and you and Angie were so gracious. So it's great to have you here today, and you're coming to us from Las Vegas?
Yes, still in Las Vegas. My contract, a lot of people don't know this, but my contract with the Mirage ended. We were supposed to do a big finale show at the end of June, and then I was going to start a whole new casino on July 1st, and then, of course, in March, 13th or 14th, Vegas just shut down, and everything got put on hold. But I still am. We're still talking to some casinos, two or three casinos. It looks like we're going to be staying in the MGM family, though. So, you know, the Mirage is part of the MGM family. So I'll definitely be back in Vegas. It just, you know, who could have seen this coming, right?
Yeah. Well, I want to talk more about that in a bit. Terry, where did you grow up? Where were you born? Where were you raised?
I was born and raised in the Dallas area. Now, we moved around a lot. We were not a military family, but a lot of people, when I tell them, we moved about every 9 months to a year and a half. My theory is this, and my mother swears this is not true, but my theory is that my parents couldn't pay or didn't pay their rent because we always left in the middle of the night. So it was like in the middle of the night, we're packing up and I'm sleeping on the floor as a 6, 7, 8 year old, and we're packing up the stuff. So there had to be something nefarious going on there, but we literally moved I think in my schooling from grade school through high school, I think I went to like, 10 or 11 different schools. So, because I was constantly being ripped out of whatever it was. And my dad was one of those church hoppers. Every time the pastor said anything he disagreed with, he would yank us out of the church and we would find another church. It was just nuts. It was completely nuts. While I was from the Dallas area my whole life, there's not a lot of roots, you know? So people say, oh, was it easy for you to move to Vegas? And I'm like, nah, not really. You know, we moved all the time.
Any siblings?
I have, my sister has gone on to be with the Lord, and my brother lives in Minnesota. So I do have one brother left.
Okay. So how would you describe your childhood then if you were constantly moving? Was it a happy childhood? Was it a stressful childhood? I mean, how did you find, you know, who you were?
It was a traumatic childhood. It was a stressful childhood, but it was a happy childhood because I always kept my faith in God, and no matter how bad things got, I would always go and into my secret place and talk to God and let Him take the burdens away from me. I was a big reader. I still love to read, but even as a child, I would read things like The Pilgrim's Progress. I read a lot of C.S. Lewis. I started with The Chronicles of Narnia, and I mean, as like a 12, 13 years old, I'm reading Mere Christianity, The Screwtape Letters, his greatest works. And so those kinds of things, and I also listened to a lot of Christian music. I grew up listening to Larry Norman.
Yeah.
And amazingly, I got to become one of his closest friends that he ever
no
had.
No way.
Yes. For the last 2 years of his life, he and I were soul brothers. And I mean, he would call me at 3 o'clock in the morning because he was having a lot of physical issues.
Yeah.
And I would always answer the phone and we would talk for hours, and my sister and he would talk for hours as well.
Why should the devil have all the good music?
That's right.
You know, in fact, one time I remember I was going into Canada to sing at a concert, and Larry and I were on the same flight. And for people who don't know who Larry Norman was, I mean, he was kind of a hippie's hippie, long, white hair.
Look him up, and his music is amazing. If you don't know who he is, look him up. His music is amazing, and his lyrics are incredible. But go ahead. Sorry, I didn't mean
to. Anyway, we're going through customs. And I just go, I'm kind of keeping an eye on him. And I'm like, you know, clean, short-haired. I'm right through customs. Larry gets up there, okay, let's take you over here, you know, because he had this long white hair, almost this Edgar Winter look, you know. Mm-hmm. But what a sweetheart. And, yeah, people should check out the music of Larry Norman. So how did you become friends with him?
That is a really interesting story. And I actually want to write a book about my time with Larry. I think a lot of people who love Christian music would love that, because we really spent a lot of time together. But what happened was I was always on his Solid Rock mailing list. And then of course, by that time, email had come along. This was a year or two before America's Got Talent, 2007. So I don't remember. I have to look it up when his 60th birthday party was. But I got this email from Solid Rock saying that Larry was having problems with his heart, and he didn't have insurance. He was trying to raise money for his heart surgery. And so they were selling tickets to his 60th birthday party. And that if you paid $1,000, you could sit at his table at his birthday party. And so I'm like, oh my gosh, you know, so I didn't have the money, but I got to tell you, I scrimped and scraved, saved and did everything I could. So I called up Solid Rock and I talked to Kristen, his sister-in-law. And I said, I've got this thousand. She said, well, we're sold out. And I said, oh, please, you don't know what this would mean to me. Larry has meant so much to me. And I said, and plus, and so she called me back and she goes, well, we did find one extra because, you know, we can use the $1,000. So we found an extra seat. We'll kind of stick you on the corner. And I said, great, great. I don't care, as long as I can be at his table. And so I said, by the way, I'm a ventriloquist. Now, this was before I was famous. This is before America's Got Talent. I said, I'm a ventriloquist. And I would love, if you would like, I would love to perform for Larry on his birthday. So she says, I don't think that's going to work, but so she calls me back about a week later and she said, you know, I didn't know this, but I talked to Larry and his big dream was to be a ventriloquist. He tried when he was young and he couldn't do it. And he went crazy when I told him a ventriloquist wanted to perform. So I worked out a routine and we went to see his show, if you can imagine this, if you're a fan of Larry's, he did the trilogy, So Long Ago the Garden, Only Visiting This Planet, and Another Land. Yeah. And I think it was that was the order that it was in. And he was going to perform all three records live for us in the order that he wanted them to be before the record company changed it. So it's like, here I am, you know, geeking out. It's like, I mean, for me, Larry was my Beatles, my Rolling Stones. He was my big, you know, so I'm thinking, oh my gosh, these are my three favorite albums in the world. And he's gonna perform them live. Well, it was cute and so charming because he kept getting lyrics and he kept doing, but it was literally like Larry was sitting in your dressing room. I mean, in your, not dressing room, that shows you I'm an entertainer, in your living room, just entertaining you. So the next night I wrote a bunch of jokes about the fact that he forgot routines. I wrote jokes about how old he was getting. And he was laughing so hard. He was pounding the table. And it was the funniest part for me, though, was he's sitting there pounding the table and everybody else in the crowd, and there probably was maybe 1,000 people there. And they're like, because I was telling jokes. At one point, I had my puppet do an impression of Larry Norman, and he forgot the lyrics. And I said, what are you doing? And he goes, I'm doing an impression of Larry from last night. And Larry was just pounding the table, and I'm laughing. So and again, nobody else laughed. Nobody else thought it was funny, and I didn't care because I'm like, well, Larry's sitting right here to my right, and he's laughing, so I'm doing this for him. So after the show, he came up and we talked for maybe an hour. He gave me his cell number and we started calling. And during my entire time on America's Got Talent, he would call me as soon as my performance was over. We would talk over the performance and we would start talking about what I was going to do the next week. And I flew him to the second to the final performance of America's Got Talent so that he could watch me live on stage there. And then I flew him to my very first performance in Las Vegas as a headliner, he and his son. And I got to tell you, man, it was such a gift that God gave us. And I think it was a gift that God gave him because of my relationship with Christ through the years, I was actually able to really help Larry through a lot of difficult things that he had, you know. People don't really realize he was a human being. He was a man just like the rest of us with his failures and his fears and his, And so so my relationship with Christ at that point, and still to this day, was so strong that I was really, really able to help him through a lot of those final years. So what an honor.
Very cool. So music has been a basic part of your life then. And you sang in a band or whatever? I mean, tell us about your music background.
I did. I was the guy that would get the little karaoke cassettes. And of course my parents wouldn't let me listen to any rock music growing up. So I would be doing Amy Grant, David Meese, Michael W. Smith, friends are friends forever. If the Lord's the Lord of them, you know, that kind of thing.
Your hand is amazing. How did you do that?
So I was able to do this. I was able to do these, and I would do these. I would sometimes I'd use a puppet at church, and then other times I'd go maybe to the college, the little college place where everybody would gather, and I would do little shows there and perform my songs. And then after I graduated from high school and I didn't really know what I wanted to do, this group came called Young American Showcase. I think it was Free Fair, and a lot of people that's watching this may remember Freedom Jam and Free Fair. They were all part of the same organization, and it was such a dynamic show. And they performed at the high school, and I went up afterwards and I said, "Man, you guys are amazing." And they said, "Well, you know, we're looking for a vocalist. Do you sing?" And I said, "Actually, I do sing." So they came to my house and I set up my little sound system and I did an audition for them, and they sent me on the road in Tucson, Arizona to start performing. And that for the rest of that year, I performed at schools, and we did 3 to 5 shows every single day, including on Saturdays. We only had Sunday off. And then that really got me going. And I met two guys on the road, a bass player and three guys, a bass player, a guitar player, and a drummer. And I called them and I said, "Why don't you come to Texas and we'll start our own band?" And we started a band called Texas the Band and played bars for a number of years, and then got into fairs. And I loved playing county and state fairs. It was a blast. Because I'm really more, I don't drink a lot. I mean, I might have a glass of wine with meal occasionally, but I'm not a drinker. And I certainly don't smoke and I don't do drugs. And so it just didn't feel right being in a bar, in bars. But being at the fairs was so much fun because you got families. And I've always been a big family entertainer. In fact, I've won Best Family Entertainment on the Strip 8 years running here before the Mirage shut down. So
how did the AGT thing happen? Tell us about the audition process, and how did you even get onto the show?
Well, a lot of people don't realize that AGT actually reaches out to professional entertainers. They think everyone just goes and it's kind of a cattle call, but they don't want all amateurs. They want to make sure they get professionals. And I guess it's a lot easier now, that because back then we weren't able to submit online. Now people, you know, millions of people can submit online from all over the world. But back then we had to actually go in person to audition. Well, the first season, somebody told me about it, and I thought, let me see. And then I watched it, and it was actually pretty. It was good. Kevin Johnson was a ventriloquist that was on there, and he was so good. And he only made it through like 2-3 episodes. I wish he had made it on more. He should have made it on more. But they were very respectful. They weren't mean, and I thought it was a gong show, you know, because I heard, oh, they're going to be Xing people, and it was. And so the second year, I'm kind of thinking, well, maybe I should think about it. And then I got a phone call from NBC, and I'm looking on my cell phone, and it says NBC. And I'm like, NBC. So I pick up the phone, and they said, "Hi, this is NBC. We're calling from America's Got Talent. We, this past year, while you were doing fairs, we got tens of thousands of emails from all over the United States telling us to check out this ventriloquist that they saw at the fair."
No way. I said,
"Are you serious?" And they said, "Yes." So we thought, "Would you like to audition for America's Got Talent?" And I thought, "Well, sure." And so they said, "Well, what's your schedule?" And I said, so I gave them my schedule, and I happened to be in Los Angeles when they were doing it. And you got to understand, I was working every single day, 6 to 7 days a week, 3 to 5 shows a day. I was doing schools and fairs and corporate events. And so I was one of the hardest working people in show business. So for me to be able to find the time was almost impossible. But I just happened to be doing schools in Los Angeles where they were doing the auditions. So they said, "Well, what time can you get there?" And I said, "I can probably be there by like 7 o'clock. I've got a school show that day." And they said, "Well, show up at 7 o'clock and we'll get you a number." And so I did. And so I walk in with my puppets, and they're telling me, they said, "You cannot do more than 5 minutes. It's a very hard and fast rule. They do not let you do more than 5 minutes because they have, you know, hundreds of thousands of people that are auditioning." I said, "Fine." So I did my 5 minutes, and there's six producers sitting at a table, and you're in an empty room with six producers at a table, and they all kind of got in a little huddle, and then they looked up at me and they said, do some more for us. And I went, oh, okay. So I pulled out a couple more puppets and I did 5 more minutes, and they all huddled again and they said, do some more for us. So I said, sure. You know, so I did another 5 minutes, and they huddle again and they look at it and they say, well, that was very impressive, but it's kind of obvious that you have a tape recorder in the puppets and that you're not really singing. And I was like, wait a second, I really am singing. And they said, I don't think so. And I said, well, what can I do? And they said, well, get right up here to our face and do an impression. So I literally got right up to him and I went, "Endless." And they literally just went, oh my gosh, this is real. And they couldn't believe it. And so at that point I thought I got on. I was like, okay, this is great. It went really well. And, you know, called my sister and I said, I think I got on. And then I didn't hear a word from anybody for months. This was in maybe October of 2006. And it went month after month. And I'm going, well, cripes, I thought I did a good job. I thought they liked me. And then maybe May, I get a phone call from America's Got Talent. And they said, are you still interested in the show? I said, of course. And they said, can you be here next week for the live audition for the judges? And I said, yes. So they got me a plane ticket and I went in and the rest is history. I thought I would get on 2 to 3 episodes and that I could raise my price at elementary schools. That was my big master plan. I never thought I would win the show. And I certainly never thought I would go directly from America's Got Talent to become a headliner in Vegas. It's like crazy, crazy story.
Okay. Now, how many episodes were you on then on the show?
I think I did 5 episodes and 6 performances, or maybe 6 episodes, because and that's including the finale where they actually named us. So I think it was like 6 episodes, and talk about nerve wracking. It was incredibly, it's funny. I don't get nervous on stage. I don't know what it is about me. I get excited. I get really, really like hyped up, you know, but I don't get nervous. And the interesting thing about it's, and I think, you know, you were asking me about my childhood. We can talk about that in a minute, go into more detail about why my childhood was so traumatic, but I learned as a child to compartmentalize things, mm-hmm. and to, you know, to compartmentalize and realize this is bad that's going on in my childhood, but this is good. So I'm going to focus on this good. So when I would get on stage and here I am, you know, performing at the time, you know, we had around 20 to 30 million people a week, and it's way less than that now. But back then in 2007, 20 to 30 million people a week. And it never even entered my mind that there were cameras and that millions of people were watching. I was so focused on the crowd right there. And I really didn't even pay attention to the judges. I kind of would look at them, but I looked at them as just another member of the crowd. I didn't look at them and focus on them as judges that could possibly buzz me or whatever. So I'm really able to kind of step out and just perform for whatever crowd I have. Small, big, doesn't matter. I love to perform.
Well, and the fact that you have performed so much, I find that I don't get nervous unless maybe I'm sick, or if it's a situation where the sound system is not. I mean, because I've been doing it so much, it's kind of second nature. You just step into that.
Yeah.
You mentioned. Let's just go back there now and share what is it about your childhood then that was so traumatic?
Well, my father was a totalitarian, and he was incredibly abusive. He didn't spank us, he beat us. All 3 of us children, he beat us. He verbally, psychologically abused us. I was also, and I'm not ashamed of this, and I'm not ashamed to admit it, I was sexually abused many, many times growing up from family members and unfortunately members of our church and things like that. So, and the reason I'm not ashamed of it is because I know other people have experienced or are experiencing that. And I want them to know that you can overcome those things. Those things do not have to dictate your life and how the trajectory and what your life, where your life goes. Your choices are what makes your life, not what other people choose to do to you. And I always realized I never did feel that there was anything wrong with what I did, because I was a victim. I was a child. I didn't, you know, I had no say in the matter. And so I feel no shame of it. But also even in the worst times, like when my father, just to give you an example of the kind of thing my dad would do, he would, uh, He was a religious person. I like to think he was a Christian, but it's hard for me to imagine a true Christian who has Christ in his heart and the Holy Spirit in his life doing things like this. But he thought my sister had snuck out with a guy. She didn't. She had not, but he thought she had, and he wanted to show her what hell was like. So he grabbed her and drug her into the kitchen and actually turned the stove on and burned her hand in the fire, to show her what her life, what her eternity was going to be like. That's the kind of abuse we suffered, and we all suffered those kinds of things. At one point he got a shotgun and threatened to kill all of us because he felt we were not obeying him enough, and that he would rather us be dead than to go to hell, you know. So he was one of those crazy, over the top, nutty, you know. He was an authoritarian that and he believed that if we disobeyed him, we disobeyed God. And it was a very traumatic thing. And but at the same time, I would go into my closet, I would close the door, and I would get on my knees and I would pray. And many times I would also put my headphones on and listen to Christian music. And those were the things that got me through, you know, these traumatic times of horrible physical, emotional, sexual abuse was Christ, just turning to Christ. And I never did lose. Well, no, okay. When I finally stood up to my father and I just told him off one day, and he goes, he said, "You'd rather go to hell than continue obeying me." And I mean, I was 30. I was 30 years old, okay? And I had basically been under his thumb until I was 30. I was too afraid. After he threatened to kill us, I was too afraid to go to disobey him. And so I stood up to him, and I walked in another room, and I said, "Yeah, I'd rather go to hell than if you're the representative of God, I don't want to be anywhere near that God." Because he's not a good God. He's a terrible God if he put you as his authority. So I went into another room and I tried to be an atheist for about, you know, 30 seconds. And I was like, I can't live without God. So I took a quarter and I said, "God, I need to know if I can't have you because I'm now no longer going to obey my father. I just need you to let me know." So I took a quarter and I said, "If it's heads, I'm going to flip it. If it's heads, that's you telling me that I can have you without my dad. If it's tails, I'll realize my dad is right, and I just won't worry about it because I'm not going back under him." And I flipped the coin, and it was heads. And I was like, "Thanks for the answer." And that's it. I never. And to be honest, if it had been tails, I probably still would have followed God because I can't live without him. I just can't. I don't know how anybody can live without God.
So, what is your dad still alive? And or how did what's that relationship look like now, or what did it look like?
No, we separated, and I was completely estranged from him from about, I think it was around 2000, the year 2000, maybe 2001. I had a conversation with him, and I said, "Look, Dad, you know, I can forgive you," and I do. I forgive him for everything he did and said and the things, but I said, "You're going to have to realize that I'm no longer that little boy. I'm no longer under your authority." At the time, I was married. And I was like, "Look, I have my own wife, I have my own family, and you are no longer the authority. God now has given me that authority in my life. And so I would love to be friends with you, but you're gonna have to understand that I'm no longer under your thumb and authority, and you'll have to look at me as an equal." And he turned away around and I never saw him again. The interesting thing is I never did get approval from him. I never did get, "I'm proud of you," never anything like that. But after he passed, he committed suicide about 6 years ago, I think, maybe 7 years ago. It might have been six. But and I never did hear from him. But then my cousin went and found is the one who found the body, and he went through his stuff, and he told me that he had kept a scrapbook of articles about me and my winning on America's Got Talent. And then when I talked to my cousin, he said that when he would play golf with people, he would tell them that he was really proud of me, that I was his son, that, you know.
Oh.
So that meant a lot, you know, that I actually bawled. I cried like a baby when I found that out. I just bawled like a baby when I found that out, because it was kind of nice to know he was proud of me.
Is that a hole that has healed, or is there still pain there?
There's definitely pain. I think the thing is that, and including my mother is an unbelievable narcissist who cares more about money than she does me. She's told me this to my face. She started writing me threatening letters a few years ago, telling me that if I didn't give her $1 million, that she was going to go to the press and destroy my reputation. And I just said, look, you know, I have a business to run. You know, people think I've got $100 million in the bank, but you know, I had at the time, I had, you know, 25 employees. I had a lot of expenses, and I just didn't have $1 million to give her. And I said, I can't, there's nothing. So she did, she went to the press and released all kinds of horrible things, just totally untrue things, but she made good on her promise to try to hurt me. And so to have a mother like that, who has flat out told me, I don't want a relationship, I want money. That's very, I don't know if most people, unless you're experiencing that, and maybe somebody out there is experiencing this. And I think the only reason that I never did go, you know, become a basket case and become a drug addict and an alcoholic is because my drug was God. I would turn to God, and I never felt unloved because I knew that God loved me so much that he sent his son to be crucified for me. And that kind of love can transcend any need in my life. But I got to say, you know, my wife, you know, went through a couple of painful divorces, and it was very difficult. You know, people think that it was like, oh, you went Hollywood. You know, the truth is my marriage was falling apart, and I thought getting rich and famous would fix it. My first one. And made it worse. Fame and fortune made it way worse. And so I just couldn't do it anymore. And then my sister, who I already said has gone on to be with the Lord, she became friends with this young lady that was in my show. And the only reason I was even interested, because I found out she was interested in me, was because I wanted to have children. I wanted to have a family. And she was in her 20s. And I thought, man, you know, it's perfect. She's young enough to where she's got the energy to raise our kids. And then as soon as we got married, she told me she changed her mind and didn't want to have kids. And I'm like, oh my gosh, what have I done? I married this young lady and she doesn't want it. The only reason I would have ever considered somebody like that. So I tried my best for that, you know, for 4 years with that. And then it just came to a head. And it's like, look, we don't want the same thing in life. And I swore off women, and I said, you know, I'm done. I don't ever want to, I'm done dating, I'm blah, blah, blah. And then, of course, like a month later, God brought my wife, Angie, into my life. And I've experienced, and I will say this, my entire life, my family, my mother, father, narcissists don't know what it means to love. I've never felt any love from them at all, real love. And for the first time in my life, I feel absolute unconditional love from a human being. And that's my wife, Angie. She has, you know, it's like, here's the way to describe it. And I know there's other people watching this that have experienced this. With my family, every time they did something good for you, you had to wait for the other shoe to drop and figure out what it was they wanted in return. They never did anything, and I can't say this about my mother or my father, that there was never anything they did for me out of love and because they cared for me. And so for maybe the first year of my marriage to Angie, and that was the same way it was with both of my other wives, and it was like, every time she would do something, like she would make a dinner for me. I would come home from my show and she would make dinner for me. And I would be like, I would tense up and I'd be like, okay, what am I going to have to do for this? And she'd be like, honey, I'm just doing it because I love you. You know, I don't. And so it took me maybe a year, might even 2 years to stop tensing up every time she did something nice for me. Because I knew something was coming, you know, something was expected. And so I'm in 5 years. We just celebrated our fifth anniversary. And 5 years in, and now I do things for her. I'll get up and make her breakfast sometimes, and sometimes she'll get up and make me breakfast. You know, sometimes I get up and bring her coffee. Sometimes she gets up and brings me coffee. And neither of us keep track of the things we're doing for each other. And I got to tell you, man, it's been bliss.
You know, and I've been able to meet Angie, and she's always been very, very gracious and kind to me. And that says a lot about her and about you. Terry, time is like flying by here, and I've got so many things I want to ask, but you know what? Is there anybody else in the room with you right now? I mean, like, are you just there by yourself, or?
Well, I'm never by myself. I'm a ventriloquist.
So let's see here. Let's see if I can find someone.
Let me get over here.
Are you here?
I am.
Okay.
She's coming. Hang on.
Oh my goodness.
Oh, hi. How are you doing, Steve?
I'm well. How are you?
Oh, I'm fantastic.
You know what? Your freckles are just amazing. I mean, they're so beautiful.
Thank you.
And your hair, who does your hair?
Oh, I do them myself. This is what I call au naturel.
Au naturel.
Right.
Oh.
Exactly.
So Terry doesn't help you with your hair. You don't need his help.
Absolutely not. He cannot touch my hair. No one but me touches my hair. And Justin Bieber.
And Justin Bieber. Oh, okay.
I'll let him touch my hair.
Are you too tight? Are you friends?
Not yet, but there's always hope.
Well, I mean, I'm glad you're here. Do you just want to talk, or is there something like what?
No, can I sing?
Yeah, yeah.
And just so you know, you asked Terry about America's Got Talent. He could not have won without me.
And you know what? She's not kidding. I absolutely could not have won that show without her, because what happened was she got on America's Got Talent.
I was the very first. And as soon as we got on stage, David Hasselhoff said, "Oh no, a ventriloquist."
That's right. If those of you out there that remember the audition, he said, "Oh no, a ventriloquist." And then this is what happened.
You gonna start the song?
I am. So. Oh, wait a minute. We gotta start it. I forgot to start it from the top.
Thank you.
There we go.
Oh, that's better. So we walked on stage.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. And at this point, the judges don't expect very much.
No, they don't. But then.
What happened?
And my love has come along. My lonely days are over. And life is like a song. Oh, yeah, and land. The skies above the blue. My heart was wrapped up in clover. The night I look at you.
Emma Taylor.
I hope Justin Bieber was watching.
Emma, just you and me for a second.
Yeah.
Why do you even need Terry?
I ask myself that same question every time we get on stage.
I do too. I don't know. I just, you know, I basically just stand here. I don't really do anything.
No, you're sitting now.
Right. I just sit here. Right. So, and I love doing those live because I put out these videos and if you're watching this, I release on Wednesdays, I release our new music videos. Every single week I release a new music video and I put it on YouTube first, youtube.com/Terry Fator. And then I put it on Facebook on Thursdays, a day later, facebook.com/Terry Fator. And you have no idea how many people will comment and say, "Well, that was good, but I wish it was live," because they don't think I actually do all of those videos live. I've got a professional microphone that's sitting right under the camera where they can't see it. And then I go in later and I put reverb and stuff.
Yeah, so he doesn't cheat. Sometimes he does.
Well, I do cheat whenever you hear, if you ever hear harmonies that, and there's not another puppet, sometimes they'll bring two puppets and do them side by side, but I will occasionally put in harmonies later. And that's
cheating.
It's not cheating.
Well, you did it with Maynard last week. Was last week or the week before you sang some harmony?
Exactly. Yes, he did. He cheated.
I did not cheat. It's not cheating. I always admit that I'm doing it.
Yeah, well, whatever.
Oh, gosh. Well, it was really nice to see you, Emma. I'm glad
you
talked
to you. Nice to see you too, Steve.
All right. I'd like to continue talking with Terry, if it's okay.
Yeah, sure. I've got things to do anyway. I'm going to call Justin Bieber.
Okay, yeah, yeah. She's obsessed with Justin Bieber.
Hey, Terry, someone wrote a question. They said, "Do all those voices you create ever come out in real life, and how long does it take you to create a new character?"
Well, each character is different. It depends on what character I'm creating.
Do you have the character, a physical idea of what they look like first, or do you have a voice and then you create a character to go with the voice?
Well, typically I will, it just totally depends. Like, for example, Maynard Tompkins, who is my Elvis impersonator, I'm trying to see if he's here.
He's not even here. No,
he's out of the building.
Yeah, he's left the building, right. I just did a show in Toledo, and he's still packed up in the case. But with Maynard, I wanted to do a puppet that could sing Elvis songs. So I bought this little Elvis looking. He looks like an Elvis. You know, he's got this little. If you just look him up, Maynard Tompkins. He did, I think, a couple of weeks ago. He did what was it? Never Walk Alone. You'll Never Walk Alone as Elvis. And with him, it took me several years to figure out what his character was, because I'd bring him on stage, and this was when I was with Texas the Band, and he would sing a song, but I couldn't figure out how to get comedy into it. Mm-hmm. And then it was like one day I came up with I was driving in my bus. I used to drive the tour bus, and it was maybe 8 o'clock in the morning, and I've been driving since midnight. And suddenly I got this idea, and I thought, oh my gosh, what if Maynard is like a country bumpkin who's never actually taken the time to learn any Elvis songs at all, but he calls himself the world's greatest Elvis impersonator, and that, boom, all of a sudden the routine started to write themselves. And I thought it was a pretty funny idea, but it took me maybe 3-4 years to come up with that. Whereas with Emma Taylor, my good friends Daryl and Sissy Johnson in Austin, Texas, they gave me this little girl puppet for Christmas one year. And I opened it up, and they said, we gave you a girl puppet because we notice you're starting to do impressions of singers, and you don't have any female singers. And I said, well, I wonder if I can do a girl voice. And I picked up this little girl puppet, and I went, Alas. I said, I guess I can do a girl voice. That's how quickly that happened. And then suddenly, the name Emma Taylor popped into my head, so she kind of named herself.
Do you, in performance, do you stay fairly scripted, or are you looking for those moments, those unpredictable things that happen with an audience member or whatever, where you can go there? What are you thinking in performance?
Well, yes and no. And the funny thing is, I always use a teleprompter for that exact reason. So I always have somebody on a teleprompter, because what will happen is, every show, a puppet might go completely off script, and I feel so sorry. Now, it used to be somebody else, but since COVID, my wife is now running the teleprompter when I'm doing comedy clubs. And I'm trying to play comedy clubs all over the country just to keep my chops up, and it's a blast. I'm loving it. Don't make a lot of money at it, but man, it's fun.
Yeah.
And so, I feel sorry for her sometimes, because I'll go way off script and just go off. And then I can see the teleprompter going up and down. The reason I like to have a teleprompter is because it gets me back on.
Yeah.
I might completely forgot where I was in the script.
Yeah.
And so I don't typically need it like all the time. But when I do have those moments where the puppet goes off, and what I've always told her is, and anyone who's running my prompter, I'll tell her, I'll tell them, if I go off script, just stay on whatever the next line is. That way I can look down and get back on track to where the script goes. And so, and especially with Maynard Tompkins, my Elvis impersonator, there are times when he just goes way, I just let him go. I just completely let him go. And it's really fun to do that.
Okay, so once you won America's Got Talent, tell us about going to Las Vegas. How did life change? What was, I mean, was your head spinning? What was life about then?
I was Jethro Bodine. I was the Clampets going into, I'm telling you, it was so crazy. Because here, I grew up, you know, we were lower middle class. We've never even been close to middle class my life. It was always been lower middle class. You know, we never had a lot. We always bought used cars. We never, you know, we were the guys, we were the ones that you would see pushing the car on the freeway because it ran out of gas, you know. And this happened to us all the time. So this was my life. And then all of a sudden I win America's Got Talent. I win $1 million. And then I get signed to a multi-million dollar deal in Las Vegas. And when I did, and at first it started at the Las Vegas Hilton, and they would put me in Barry Manilow's suite, which was, it was at the top of the Las Vegas Hilton. It had gold, I mean, it's crazy. It had like gold angels and huge artwork, and it had spiral staircases, and it was nuts. So I would call all my friends, and and Daryl and Sissy, I told you about them. They actually came and stayed with me there. And one time we had a pajama party. They had all their friends and cousins were in town, and I said, bring them on over to Barry Manilow's suite. We'll go to my show, and then everybody can. Oh. And we all stayed in our pajamas all night, and got there was a hot tub that could hold 50 people. So they said, bring your swimsuits, and we were all sitting in there, you know, sipping champagne. So I went from lower middle class Texas, you know, living in Corsicana, Texas. I moved there when I was 14. And so this is like a country boy town. And now suddenly I'm in Barry Manilow's suite at the Hilton. And so, you know, when they have bathtubs that are so gigantic, that are humongous, it's crazy. So it took me a little while to get used to that. But the thing is I didn't, even though it does, you know, I ended up with two divorces. I really didn't ever let it go to my head and go crazy. And, you know, I was always very, most of my money that I've made, I've given to charity. And other people, you know, I have no desire to be the richest man in the world. I feel like we're on this planet to help others. And so whatever God blesses me with, I'm gonna bless others
being
with.
Being the second richest man in the world, that's okay. You know, you don't have to be number one. So, hey, someone has asked here, and I don't know if he's around. Someone just wanted to know if Rusty was around any place.
You know what? Rusty is not around. I think he's actually, he's in storage right now and the reason is he has all these little technical things that go on in his, his head opens and the little guy inside. And so there's a lot of technical stuff. Same thing with Justin Bieber. I don't have him because he has a Dolly Parton and a Ozzy Osbourne that pops up on his shoulder. Dolly is the angel and Ozzy is the devil.
so with COVID, tell us, how has life changed for you? And what does the future look like for you and for Las Vegas?
Well, it's been incredibly difficult, just like anybody else. You know, I was able to pay my employees for a few months, and then, you know, it was supposed to only last for, a couple of months. And then as the months went on, I just ran out of money to pay employees. So I just recently had to lay off all of my employees. I've got myself, my wife, and Randy Key, who is my production manager, and he's still with me because he's, you know, he helps me run the comedy shows. You know, we're doing the best we can. It was quite a shock. You know, you don't expect to suddenly have every single penny that you're making stop instantaneously, and it was overnight. I mean, it was like March 13th, I think, and we had no, there was literally no time for us. I did a show on Thursday at the Mirage, and on that next Sunday, we got a call that said, you need to come and get your stuff. We're locking the Mirage and you won't be able to get in. So we all of us, you know, my musicians, and we all went in, and I got my puppets and I got as many things as I possibly could out of the Mirage. And then it closed down, and I think it's reopened, but they're not reopening any entertainment. And so the good thing is that it's not a permanent thing, because all of my road shows, but that same weekend, every single road show that I had, and I had maybe 25 on the, I would have been fine if I'd been able to do my road shows. Every one of them canceled. They didn't cancel, they postponed to 2021. Yep. So basically everything stopped. All money stopped, and all income stopped. And so, you know, we're limping along. We're doing the best we can. And like I said, people think I have $100 million. I don't. You know, I've been too generous, and I've been too, and there's been some, I've had a lot of bad people in my life that have done a lot of bad things and stolen a lot of the money that I made. But, you know, God is good, and it's none of it's my fault. It's all been my trust. I've been too trusting to people that I shouldn't have trusted. And I know God is faithful, though, you know. And as long as I have Angie by my side, I don't care. If I lose everything, I'll rebuild with Angie and God. I'll rebuild as soon as things start up again.
Well, and people don't understand, it's just not Terry Fator standing up there on the stage. You, as you mentioned, you have a staff. You have people mm-hmm. that help you do what you do. And people who run small businesses, which is what you are.
Mine was a small business.
And they don't understand the impact there.
Well, see, what they don't realize is that when you get a big contract in a theater in Vegas, You know, you I don't make all the money that I make. I have to give a percentage to the casino. Then I have to pay all the employees that work my theater. I have to pay for all the upkeep of my theater. I have to pay for all of the advertising. So if you saw billboards, taxi cabs, everything was paid for by me, everything.
No.
So yes, so this was not a, you know, and while the money was huge, I got to see this much of it, you know, personally. Again, I don't need much. I'm not a person who, I don't buy tons of cars. I bought a car for myself and a car for my wife. And when COVID happened, we sold one of them. So we only have one car now, you know, to help give us a little extra money to get through this. You know, I don't have a plane. I don't have, you know, I don't overlive. I haven't bought a bunch of houses and everything. I put all of my investments into my business and into my employees. And I was very, very generous to my employees. And there, a couple of them even retired. They made so much money with me after, for the 10 years that they were with me, or the 11 years, they were able to retire. And I'm very proud of that I was able to help them in that way. So, you know, and again, I've always been incredibly generous, and God is faithful. You know, it'll come back.
You know what? There's this past week, David sent a question, and his question is, the importance of Jesus. How is the importance of Jesus? What importance does it play in your life? He says, I'm a retired New York police department Christian who gets so much joy watching Terry perform, getting me through tough times, having experienced the devastation and the pain of 9/11. He sees your witness. And Terry, I'll say this, as I've seen you perform, it's not like you plaster Jesus all over the place, but you don't have to. Some of my most powerful concerts, I never said the word Jesus, but people sense the spirit in me as I was singing and as I was performing. Do you find that to be the case?
Absolutely. I think the greatest witness we can possibly have is our life, not our what we say. So if you're living it, people are going to feel it. I've had countless people come up to me and say, you're a believer, aren't you? And I'm like, absolutely. How did you know? And they say, oh, it's kind of obvious. And I'm like, yeah. And you know, what was his name? David, was it?
David, yes.
David. You know, he asked the importance of Jesus. What else can I say? But there is nothing else that is important. You know, I remember I went to the Rock and Roll Hall of Fame a couple of years ago, and I'm looking around, and it's quite spectacular. It's quite amazing. And you're looking at handwritten, some of the greatest songs of all time by John Lennon, handwritten lyrics, and things that are written by the Rolling Stones, and things that are written by, you know, some of the greatest songwriters in the history of rock and roll, of rock music. And as I'm watching this, I'm looking at this, I'm thinking, he's no longer with us. She's no longer with us. They're gone. He's gone. You know, and I thought, is this really something to aspire to? I mean, not that you shouldn't aspire to something that will last beyond you, but what about you? You know, the only thing that matters is what happens, because we're all gonna be there. We're all gonna go. We're all gonna die. At some point, we're all gonna go to the next life. And if you write the greatest song in the history of songs and you don't know Jesus, it means nothing. It's literally meaningless. Because it doesn't matter how many people that affect, if it's not leading them to also find Christ and to find Jesus. And that's just how I feel. I feel like that we should all, and I don't mean like we have to be holy rollers and run around spouting Bible verses all the time. That's why I say live it with your life. Your life should shine your love for Christ, and should shine that you are a believer and that you are someone who loves Christ. And that's the only thing you're going to be able to take with you. Doesn't matter. Nothing else you do. I don't care if I'm the greatest ventriloquist that ever lived. I don't need to have that. I care that people were impacted by my relationship with Christ, and that's what I'm going to take with me, not what a good ventriloquist I was.
Hey, I'm trying to look. Is there anybody else in the room with you?
There actually is. He's in his shell right now. Let me see if I can get him up here. Are you okay?
Do I have to wake up now?
Yes, you do. Okay.
Oh, hi, Steve.
How are you doing?
Oh, I'm doing so good.
Have you been listening to us?
No, I've been asleep.
You haven't heard a thing we said?
Not really. Was it good?
Oh, it's very good. Very profound.
Hey, has anyone told you that you have lovely eyes?
Oh, that's so sweet. Yeah, I hear it all the time.
Well, how during these days of COVID, have you been doing all right? I mean, are you resting? Are you, what are you doing with yourself?
I'm doing good. You know, Terry and I do videos all the time.
Yeah, he loves to do, and if you look, he did Rainbow Connection a few weeks back, and wow.
It was quite impressive.
No, you let me say that. Oh, sorry. It was quite impressive.
Oh, thank you. That's so nice of you.
Hey, you know what? Can you give us those the Facebook and the YouTube URLs again, where we can see some of the videos?
Yeah, everything is hashtag Terry Fator, at Terry Fator, YouTube/Terry Fator, and Facebook/Terry Fator. Facebook.com/Terry Fator.
Right. So everything is Terry Fator.
Right. And by the way, it should be Winston in the Impersonating Turtle, but Terry made a terrible mistake with that.
Well, because we know, look, Emma is the one who kind of got me my fame, because when she sang it last, the America went crazy. And then, of course,
when I sang my song, Crying.
Right. But we're not going to do Crying. We're not. No. Do you mind if he sings a song?
I mean, it's his show.
Okay. Will you sing with me?
I would love to. So, why don't we tell how we met?
Okay.
So this is a true story. So, I was on America's Got Talent, and I had this little Kermit the Frog puppet that I was using, and I would sing What a Wonderful World, where I would sing as Louis Armstrong, and Kermit would of course sing as Kermit. And when I told the producers I wanted to do this for my second performance, and the producers of America's Got Talent thought it was a great idea, so they told me I had to get permission from the Muppets.
Right.
So they gave me the number for the Muppets, and I called up the people who represent the Muppets and asked them, and they said I could not use the Kermit puppet on television. So I didn't know what to do. So I was in Hollywood. That's where the show was shot. And I was walking next to this pond.
He was pondering.
Right. Okay. Anyway. And so
I stuck my head right out of the water, and I saw this lonely looking ugly guy.
Ugly?
Yeah. Okay. And I said, hey, you look a little down.
And I said, well, Mr. Turtle, I am a little down.
And then I said, is there anything?
And this is all true, by the way.
Yeah, it is. I said, is there anything I can do to help?
And I'm going to try to start this song right on cue. Okay.
Okay.
So, and what did you say?
I said,
hi ho, Kermit D. Frog here. Right. There we go. Perfect. I see trees of green, red roses too. I see them bloom for me and you. And I think to myself, what a wonderful world.
Okay, Terry, you sing like Louis Armstrong.
Okay, here we go.
I see skies of blue and clouds of white, bright blessed days, the dark sacred night.
And I think to myself, what a wonderful world.
The colors of the rainbow, so pretty in the sky, are also on the faces of people going by.
I see friends shaking hands, saying how do you do, fairly saying I love you.
I hear babies cry, watch them grow, they learn much more, now them know.
And I think to myself, what a wonderful world. I think to myself,
you finish.
Okay.
What a wonderful world. Oh, yes.
There you go. Me and Winston.
God, Winston, you did a lovely job.
Thank you.
Can I just finish the interview with you, or do you need Terry to stick around, or
no,
what?
No, no, no. Yeah, you can. Yeah, just ignore us.
Okay, I'll just ignore you.
So Winston, do you enjoy working with Terry?
I actually do. You know, I didn't really have much of a thought on that before. I would entertain on lily pads and entertain the other bugs and fish and stuff. But it's way more fun being with Terry because I get to perform for people.
Okay, what is the toughest thing about working with Terry?
Where his hand is right now. He needs to cut his fingernails.
You know, Winston, maybe I took this too far. If you need to go, you can go.
No, I've learned to enjoy it.
Oh, stop it. That's terrible.
Oh, I love it. Well, I mean, Winston, you can hang around if you want to. I've got a couple more questions for Terry, but you can, it's your decision.
No, I'll let him take the spotlight there and then, okay, Winston the impersonating girl.
Winston, by the way, somebody wrote, they said that they loved your bow tie.
Oh, thank you. You know, it's removable. I can do it. I did it black tie when we did Terry's 10th anniversary.
Yeah, he can remove it. And he actually has a little camo one for when we perform for military.
I do.
So you never know what you're going to see.
Yeah.
Well, Winston, thanks for coming in. Gosh. I got a couple of questions here, Terry. Do you plan on doing a virtual show? And I know you're doing the videos. You've talked about that. Do you plan on doing a virtual show? And so Darla wrote and said, have you and Jeff Dunham ever thought of doing a special together?
As far as virtual show, I don't have any plans to do that, but I do have agents and they're talking to different, you know, I wouldn't do it on my own. I would definitely be doing it in tandem with a production company. So I don't have any plans on that, but we will be starting up our live show in Vegas as soon as they reopen live entertainment in Vegas. As far as doing something with Jeff Dunham, I'm a huge fan of Jeff's. He's a huge influence on me. I loved him. I was a big fan of his growing up. But I don't think Jeff would do a show with me. However, Darcy Lynn and I are in talks right now to do some touring together. So, and we're going to be, in fact, we're doing I think we've decided we're going to start doing some duets. Me and Darcy are going to do some duets in my weekly videos that we release. So we're working on one right now. So just watch for that.
What are you hearing about Vegas then? Our end of the year, sometime next year? When do you think things are going to start to open up?
We are hearing absolutely nothing. And I know my agent is fervently trying to get information, but we just don't know. And you know, I'm blessed. God has blessed me to a point where it's not completely going to destroy me unless, you know, if it goes on to a certain area, it will physically destroy me. You know, I might lose all of my physical things, which I don't care. As long as I have my health and my wife, I'm good. And my puppets, you know, I'm going to be fine. But there have been a lot of people that have been absolutely and utterly destroyed. Their whole entire lives have been destroyed through this. So we just got to keep praying for everybody. And we need to get this thing, this economy going. Entertainment in Vegas has just taken a massive, massive blow from this. So I'm hoping, just praying that that things get open soon, not just for myself, but for any and all entertainers. But just not just that, sound people, light people, people that worked on all of the, you know, the behind the scenes. Everybody's lost their jobs. I mean, hundreds and hundreds and hundreds, if not thousands of people from Cirque shows have just been laid off.
Yeah.
Because you know, it's terrible. It's really terrible.
Well, I was flying home from D.C. last night, and I read an article as I was flying about Las Vegas and what the government has done really to Las Vegas, and it's not a good thing.
My personal viewpoint on this whole thing is that the lockdown should have been voluntary. It should have been, if you feel you're at risk, you need to stay home. If you want to brave it, wear a mask. You know, I just think that compulsory lockdown, I don't think it's constitutional. I don't think it's not American. You know, I don't know where in the Constitution it says that if there's a virus, you can force people not to work. But I'm a libertarian and I'm a big constitutionalist. So more than I am like a Republican or Democrat, I'm just really more about freedom. And I feel like that this has just been an unbelievable infringement on our freedoms, an unprecedented in the history of our country, infringement on our freedoms. But, you know, who am I to say? but just please, God, help us to get open soon.
Yeah. Well, Terry, I want to thank you for your friendship, first of all, over these years that we've been able to see each other. I want to thank you for your witness. Just that is, you know, some people are, they're Christians and you know it. And your faith just comes so naturally. I want to thank you for your witness, just your life, but also on stage. I do this on every, on all of these conversations that I've been having. Heavenly Father, I pray for Terry today. I pray for Terry and Angie. Lord, I pray for his career, for his livelihood, for the employees that he's had to let go. I pray for them. I pray that you would provide for them. I pray for Terry's health and his vocal health, that you help him keep his chops up, that you protect him, keep him safe and keep him healthy. We pray for cities around the nation, especially Las Vegas, and the people that have been impacted so adversely there. So I thank you for Terry, for Angie. Pray your hand would be upon them and all his puppets also. Keep them healthy and safe. Help them today. But I thank you for Terry and ask a hand of blessing, your hand of blessing on him today. And I pray this in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen. Amen.
Terry Fator, what a great guy. I'll call you a sweetheart. You're just you're a sweetheart, and I love you, Terry Fator. Thanks for making time for us today.
Thank you, Steve. And you know, I think you're a sweetheart too. And we the people back out there don't know, but Steve and I text each other pretty regularly. We love memes, don't we, Steve?
We do.
Memes are always fun.
We do.
Okay. You know, the funny thing is, if we have time, real quickly, yes. people don't realize, though, that memes are nothing new, because when I was a kid, I remember my dad would bring these papers home with jokes on them. That's really all we're doing. We're doing the same thing. You know, he would go to the office and bring jokes home. And then when faxes came along, do you remember, people would fax a list of jokes. And so memes are just the new way of doing that. We've been doing that forever. Cavemen used to put them on walls.
I've got a couple of new ones for you. I'll send you.
I can't wait.
All right. Terry, I love you, bud.
Love you too, man.
See ya.